Okay, I mean, रतां परिये चरन्ति
हयन्ति
हन्ति अपधारणशनेषु च यो गृह्णन्ति कमलनाभवापवार्गम् आशाति ये यदि आशिषयिष्यन्ये
वतारुकेय विरतं परिये चरन्ति शनेषु च यो गृह्णन्ति दन्ति ते कमलनाभवापवार्गम् अशासते यदि च आशिष ईशनन्ये
वैष्णवीस् what? Your paruke slippers. Aviratam, constantly. Padi, fully. Ye, who? Charanti, sir. Jayanti, meditate upon. Abhadra, of inauspicious things. Nashane, which caused the destruction. Shruchaya, purify, grinanti, and describe in their words. Vindanti, obtain. Te, they. Kamala, like a lotus. Naba, O you whose navel. Bhava, of material life. Upavagam, the cessation. Ashasate, harbor desires. Yadi, if. Te, they. Ashisha, attain the desired objects. Isha, O Lord. Na, not. Anye, other persons. Translation. Purified persons who constantly serve, meditate upon, and glorify your shoes, which destroy everything inauspicious, are sure to obtain freedom from material existence. O lotus-naveled one, even if they desire something in this world, they obtain it. Whereas others, those who do not take shelter of you, are never satisfied, O Lord. Purport. Srila Prabhupada writes in this connection that liberated Krishna conscious persons do not even desire to become free from this material existence or to enjoy material opulences. Their desires are fulfilled by Krishna conscious activities. As far as we, King Yudhisthira, are concerned, we are fully surrendered unto your lotus feet, and by your grace, we are so fortunate to see you personally. Therefore, naturally, we have no desire for material opulences. The verdict of the Vedic wisdom is that you are the Supreme Personality of Godhead. I want to establish this fact, and I also want to show the world the difference between accepting you as the Supreme Personality of Godhead and accepting you as an ordinary, powerful, historical person. I wish to show the world that one can attain the highest perfection of life simply by taking shelter at your lotus feet, exactly as one can satisfy the branches, twigs, leaves, and flowers of an entire tree simply by watering the root. Thus, if one takes to Krishna consciousness, his life becomes fulfilled, both materially and spiritually. Srila Vishwanath Thakur Chakravarti Thakur simply explains King Yudhisthira's statement. We feel no great urgency to perform the Rajasuya sacrifice, nor do we have any personal interest, since we are already seeing your lotus feet, and by your boundless mercy have been taken into your personal association. But in this world, there are some whose hearts are contaminated and who thus think that you are not the Supreme Personality of Godhead, but an ordinary man. Or else they find fault with you and even criticize you. This is an arrow piercing our hearts. Therefore, to extract this arrow from our heart, we must call to this place on the pretext of the Rajasuya. Brahma, Rudra, and otherwise brahmacharis and demigods who reside in each of the 14 planetary systems. When such an exalted congregation has assembled, it will be incumbent upon them to first arrange for the Agra Puja, or the first worship for the most worthy person present. And when they are directly shown that you, Lord Krishna, are the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the arrow piercing our heart will be removed. Om Gana Timirandasya Gananjana Shalakaya Chakshur Lilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Guru Venama Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadha Shivasini Gaur Bhaktivinoda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. You are witnessing Maharaj Yudhisthira's expression of love. Love means that two things. You can never stop glorifying the beloved, and secondly, that it's very difficult to tolerate any minimization by others of the beloved. So this is Yudhisthira Maharaj's program. He wants to see Krishna glorified, and he wants to see any misconceptions about Krishna dispelled. This is also our affair. We want to firmly establish that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and secondly, we want to dissuade persons from thinking that Krishna is ordinary, mythological. These days, people claim to be more tolerant, and therefore they'll say that we appreciate your Krishna. He's one of the greatest symbols in the world's cultural history. The world is full of various symbolism. We respect all the different religions with their symbols. The various symbols inspire the human nature to rise to higher levels. But implicit in their statement of non-sectarianism and tolerance, implicit in that statement is beyond the symbols, though. The undefined, the divine, spirit, the all-pervading. There is an all-pervading aspect of the Supreme Absolute Truth. We know. Those who actually know the spiritual science in depth have explained that the Supreme Absolute Truth is approachable in three aspects. So there is an all-pervading. But Krishna clearly explains in Bhagavad Gita, Brahmanohipratishtaham, that all-pervadingness is based upon me, the person. I so often explain that even using common sense logic, it takes a person to be impersonal. Just like when I got off the plane from Kiev at London Heathrow yesterday, Rishi was there to personally greet me. So, otherwise, normally I get off the plane and it's just, you know, it's impersonal. Because nowadays, I notice a big change. The airline's crew, they personally say farewell to everyone. All the airlines suddenly are doing that this year. Must be a fad that's caught on or whatever. Thank you, sir. See you later, sir. So, to have someone personally waiting for you, it makes such a difference. You forget all the pains and ills of traveling. But still, there's impersonalism. It takes a person to be personal, and it takes a person to be impersonal. You all have experience of giving someone the cold shoulder, right? Pretending they don't exist. That's being impersonal. So Krishna, being the Supreme Person, has an impersonal manifestation. The mistake is to think that that impersonal is beyond Krishna. I often explain that as soon as you say the words beyond Krishna, you should know you're speaking gibberish, nonsense. That it's, there's no such thing. As Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, there's nothing beyond me. When Krishna says there's nothing beyond him, that means not even Vishnu or Narayan. That's the full meaning of the statement. Everything rests upon him as pearls of strong. Krishna is just a symbol. It sounds very sectarian. Excuse me. It sounds very non-sectarian to think that way. Yeah, I respect all the symbols. I'm inspired by all the myths of the world. All the spiritual cultures of the world, they make me enthusiastic. They have something to teach you. You see, maybe 30 years ago, myth had a pejorative, negative connotation. But now, in the new wave of so-called open-mindedness, myth is positive. Yes, you can learn from myths. They teach you about basic themes in human nature and in the world history. So respect all the myths. Just recognize them as myths and profit from them. But this so-called open-mindedness, man considers that if you focus too much on Krishna, though, at the expense of the other myths, then you are cutting yourself off from the world's wealth of spiritual motifs, the wealth of spiritual symbolism. Why should you narrow yourself? In my travels around the world, especially in first world countries, they have this idea that, okay, Krishna is nice, but why do you narrow your options by simply focusing on Krishna? Wouldn't it be more humane? Wouldn't it be more universal if you're just recognizing that behind all the symbols is that undefinable reality? So yes, you have attachment for your particular symbols, but at the same time, you know there's something higher. Why should you narrow your vision? So sometimes even our devotees, they become afraid. Maybe I'm being sectarian. Too much Krishna. You've seen that verse in Bhagavad Gita warning you of too much Krishna. Yes? What verse is that? What chapter? They become afraid that if you stress Krishna too much, people will think that you're a Taliban. Fundamentalism. What's the new one? Islamic State, whatever. So therefore, best to just back off and de-emphasize Krishna, because sectarianism is very much looked down upon. But the point is the Krishna focus sectarian? If you actually understand who is Krishna, then you understand that by approaching Krishna, you are doing the most universal thing. You are being the most broad-minded. And I said, well, wait a minute. This verse says, Tvapaduke aviratam Padiyek charanti. Purify persons who constantly serve, meditate upon, and glorify your shoes. Now, isn't that really focused and narrow? This is the mysticism of bhakti yoga. By focusing on Krishna's lotus feet, even by focusing on his shoes, you open yourself up to the unlimited. There are inconceivably unlimited opportunities that open up by focusing on Krishna's lotus feet. Why should we have this implicit assumption, this prejudice, that focusing on Krishna is narrow? How do you know? If you're an honest person, at best you should just say, I don't know. Could be. But to have a predisposed conclusion that, okay, Krishna's really nice. I've even heard it, you know, from scholars. Krishna's cool. We like Krishna. He's one of the most exciting symbols in the world. You know, the Hindu forest love god. Excited, you know. We respect it. And we really relish the Vaishnav culture with all its diversity and color. And here's the word they use, pageantry. Now you can understand why Yudhisthira wants to do the Rajasvya Yajna. He has three goals in mind. Those three goals were important 5,000 years ago, and those three goals are also important today. Goal number one. Yudhisthira Maharaj is a Kshatriya. He's goal oriented. He's got mission statements. He's got protocols, procedures. He can manage the whole world. So goal number one, he wants to establish the supremacy of Krishna. He wants to make it clear that Krishna is not an ordinary historical person. He wants to create a big pageant, a big exposition. Just like when London had the Olympics, they made such a big deal out of it. So, just think how an enlightened Krishna conscious leader wants to make a huge exposition, greater than anything else that's happened in the world, just to establish that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So management's required for the Olympics, management's required for what Yudhisthira is doing, and he's capable of pulling it off. So, that's goal number one, to establish Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Goal number two is to demonstrate the power of bhakti. Bhakti is not an ordinary activity, it's not a material activity, it's not about religious belief. It is about the process handed down through parampara for pleasing the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So Yudhisthira wants to demonstrate what is that power of bhakti. How bhakti can fulfill all desires. As the verse states, Kamala Nabha, O lotus-naveled one, Krishna. Even if persons desire something in this world, they obtain it. Whereas others, those who do not take shelter of you, are never satisfied. This is the Bhagavatam's conclusion, as stated by Shukadeva Goswami in Second Canto. Akama, sarvakama, va, mokshakama, udharati. Whether you are free from material desires or full of material desires, or you're focused on liberation, freedom from material existence, never mind. Just engage in devotional service. Tivrena, bhakti yogena. Engage in bhakti with the concentration of a ray of sun, with the intensity of a sun ray. So Yudhisthira Maharaj is making it clear, even if you want something material, still take shelter of Krishna. Then again, of course, he's saying, as for we Pandavas, we don't want anything material. We're not performing the Rajasuya Yajna for ourselves, actually. We're satisfied by having Krishna's personal association. But we're thinking of the others. We don't need anything from the demigods. We have Krishna in our midst. But we're going to invite all the demigods, even Brahma, Shiva. We're going to invite them. We're going to invite all the greatest rishis, sages, scholars of metaphysics. All the great brahmacharis from every one of the 14 planetary systems. Yudhisthira, in this way, is showing you the ingredients of a real human civilization. A real human civilization involves demigods, sages, sadhus, brahmacharis. Yudhisthira Maharaj says, let them all come, and in their presence, it'll be established that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And number two, it'll be established that devotional service is no ordinary affair. It indeed is the solution to all material and spiritual problems. Sometimes even our own devotees have a little difficulty accepting devotional service is the solution to all material problems. Mm-hmm. Well, I've been serving Krishna for a few years and I just don't have everything I want. I don't have all the money I want. I haven't found the perfect partner yet. Been through a few, but still, best one hasn't dropped out of the sky yet. And you say that Krishna fulfills all desires. Anyway, if there's a guest at the Sunday feast, I always tell that to the guest. Just serve Krishna. He fulfills all material desires. You know, I adhere to the party line. But for myself, I don't know. In private and amongst my friends, you know, we sometimes discuss, why is Krishna doing this to me? Why hasn't Krishna given me this or given me that? It takes purified vision to see how Krishna is indeed arranging perfectly for us to go back to Godhead. But we have to agree with Krishna's purpose for the material world. The purpose of the material world is not to materially fulfill you. Its purpose is... The real purpose of the material world is to reform conditioned souls. So once we agree with Krishna's purpose for existence, then we calm down and we stop imposing upon Krishna. Why didn't I get this? Why didn't I get that? Don't you know I need this? Don't you know I need that? We start to understand that Krishna wants to teach us that we actually just need his holy name, devotional service, and the association of devotees. That is real wealth, especially in Kali Yuga. So Yudhisthira feels a strong necessity. Goal number two, have this yajna, which for the Pandavas is unnecessary, but for the people of the whole material world, it's necessary. So that everyone can see that any kind of prosperity is achieved by worshiping Krishna's lotus feet, even just worshiping his shoes. And then goal number three, Yudhisthira Maharaj wants to do away with this notion that any path you take takes you to the same goal. He wants to show, he says, the different stations in life that you achieve by your different activities. He wants to completely dispel the notion that no matter what you do, you wind up the same place. The bhaktas, the yogis, the gyanis, the karmis. Just be a good person, as I say today. Just be a good person, it'll work out. The universe will smile upon you. Just try to be as good as you can while trying to please yourself. In other words, don't step on too many people. Don't hurt too many people. You got to do what you got to do, but try to be a nice person and things will work out for you. This is the popular vision today. But Yudhisthira wants to show that those who practice bhakti get one thing, those who don't get another thing. Ooh, sectarianism. What about that verse in Bhagavad Gita? Ashradadana purusha. What's the next line? Dharmasya. Apropyamam navartante mrityu samsaravar. Krishna says, all right, you don't want me? You don't want to engage in bhakti? Then what? Whatever. All paths lead to the same goal. No. Apropyamam, not getting me, you do get something. What is it, though? Mrityu samsaravartmani. You get the path of repeated birth and death. So in that way, Krishna shows, yes, everyone gets something, but it's not the same. Yudhisthira Maharaj wants to firmly establish that point. He wants to show the different destinations that you'll get by taking different paths. Now, is that sectarianism? Just like often Gaurika Shohru and his wife are driving back and forth to here. So I'm always asking, is this the best way to London? Is this the quickest way? Sometimes they have to, especially his wife knows all the back roads and she knows how to figure out how to get around traffic. And sometimes they even take me ways I've never even seen, you know, before. 15, 20 years I've been coming here. So, do all the roads lead to London? That expression, all roads lead to Rome. How do you know that all roads lead to London? To say that implies what? It implies that you have an overview, that you're in a helicopter above London, or you have some kind of direct satellite connection, and you can see all the roads converging on London. If you don't have that, how can you say then that all paths lead to the same goal? Where's your superior vantage point? Tell us what it is. Tell us what you're seeing. In other words, if you don't know what the destination is, how can you say all paths lead there? So whenever someone says that, excuse me, well, anyway, you know, your Krishna is nice, wonderful symbol, but all paths lead to the same goal. Oh, what's the goal? Well, I don't know, but all paths lead there. It doesn't make any sense. You beg them, please tell me what the goal is so we can see how all the paths are going there. No, no, all you need to know is that all paths lead to the same goal. But no one knows what the goal is. And where is your superior vantage point? Supposedly, from which you can see all the roads leading to the same goal. Now, of course, if you want to go from Heathrow to London, I guess you could cross over to Ireland somehow or other. I guess you'd take a ferry. And then from Ireland, I don't know, maybe there's some way you can get to France. Then you can go down to Saudi Arabia, up to Moscow. And practically speaking, you'll never get to your destination. Especially if you go through Syria. You'll never get to your destination. You get beheaded. So, what's the use in saying all roads lead to a place? You want the quickest road and the safest road. Some roads may seem that you're going to the destination, but they're so dangerous you'll never get there. So what's the use in saying that the road will take me there? Theoretically, it may seem it does, but it's so dangerous. You'll be killed before you arrive at your destination. So we are not sectarian. By focusing on Krishna, by stressing Krishna, we're not sectarian. But we do have an obligation, as Yudhisthira Maharaj himself felt, to educate people who is Krishna. We recognize they have that fear, they have that anxiety because of the damage that fundamentalism has done to the world. Everyone's afraid of fundamentalism. I remember during my university years at Yale, the students would be, we'd be in one of the cafeterias having lunch, and then someone would spread the word, the God Squad is coming. Into the cafeteria would walk these clean-cut Christian-looking guys. Yeah. It was back in a time where everyone had long hair, bell-bottoms. And but yet, into the cafeteria at school comes these real clean-cut, you know, really focused-looking young Christians. And so the whole cafeteria would start buzzing. These guys are weird. And now the paranoia about fanaticism and sectarianism has increased even more due to the activities of various fundamentalist religious groups, whether this religion, that religion, Hindu, Christian, Muslim, whatever. But people are, the general people are tired of fundamentalism. They seem there's been loss of life, destruction caused by it. So yes, we have to operate in that environment, which makes it a challenge for us how to not lose our sight on Krishna. Not lose our sight on Krishna's shoes. We have the obligation to educate people about Krishna. Just as Yudhisthira Maharaj, he recognized, even though Krishna is physically present in this world, to ordinary vision, anyone can see him. Very few know who he is. Krishna himself explains this in Bhagavad Gita. Avajananti mamudha. Fools think I'm an ordinary person. Unintelligent people think first I was impersonal, then I became personal. So in Bhagavad Gita, he's revealing his concerns. Just like if you're misunderstood, you want to tell someone. Of course, Krishna has nothing he needs to do. But to help us, he's expressing himself. People misunderstand me. They think this, they think that. And obviously someone who cares, someone who wants to develop love for Krishna, they listen to Krishna express his concerns, how he's misunderstood. You don't like me being misunderstood. It's a very painful feeling. You have one intent, and someone thinks that you had another intent. They tell others about it. They ascribe some even evil intent to you, or devious intent to you. Or sometimes they say, he's got an agenda. Well, everyone's got an agenda. What is the agenda? Oh no, she's got an agenda. You can't be in this world, and you can't be sentient without having an agenda. But the point is, what is the agenda? In any case, no one likes to be misunderstood. It's very painful. Krishna, of course, doesn't undergo any material pain or anxiety. He wants his parts and parcels to understand him because it's for their highest benefit. The reward for understanding Krishna is so great that he says, evam yo veti tatvataha, if you can understand me in truth, then chakva deham punarjanma nanti mam etu sojana. Upon giving up the present body, you won't take another material body. Mam eti, you'll come to me. That's how important understanding Krishna is. So it's not that Krishna has some kind of complex, oh, they don't understand me. What am I going to do? No. He wants the ultimate perfection for all his parts and parcels. It's not that Krishna is moping in depression that they don't understand me. No, Krishna's always enjoying his leelas. And through his leelas, he's inviting the conditioned souls. This is your real self-interest, please join. Just as Yudhisthira Maharaj is feeling the necessity in his time to firmly establish that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Similarly, in our time, we also feel that necessity. We want to achieve Yudhisthira Maharaj's three goals. Establish Krishna's supremacy, number one. Number two, show the power of bhakti. And number three, to show that different activities, different paths will take you to different places in the universe. What Yudhisthira is doing is an expression of his love. You're going to see that once the Rajasuya Yajna gets going. You're going to see Yudhisthira Maharaj tears gliding down his face because he has a chance to worship Krishna. You're going to see his ecstasy come to the fore. He can't restrain it. All his family members participate in the worship of Krishna. Now, there's a hidden motive, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, or Jiva Goswami. One of the acharyas said, Yudhisthira Maharaj has a hidden motive for doing the Rajasuya Yajna, which he didn't tell Krishna because he was shy. What do you need in order to perform the Rajasuya Yajna? You need unparalleled wealth. The only way you're going to get that wealth is all the subordinate kings of the world offer some resources so that the Rajasuya Yajna can go on. So, Yudhisthira's hidden reason, the acharyas explain, part of the reason for arranging the Rajasuya Yajna was he wanted to take all the wealth of the world and give it to Krishna. But he wasn't going to tell that to Krishna. Of course, Krishna can know whatever he wants. But out of love, there are these exchanges with his devotees. So Yudhisthira didn't mention that. He just said, I want to worship you, I want to show the world your glories. But also in the back of his mind, we Pandavas are going to take all the wealth of the world and give it to you. That's why Arjuna has that name, Dhananjaya, the grabber of wealth. So, these are the activities and mentalities of a devotee. As Prabhupada writes so eloquently in the Krishna book, which is quoted extensively in this purport. We, meaning the Pandavas, feel no great urgency to perform the Rajasuya sacrifice. Nor do we have any personal interest, since we are already seeing your lotus feet and by your boundless mercy have been taken into your personal association. But in this world, He's practical. He's a king. He's an executive. It's not all peaches and cream in this world. In this world, there are some whose hearts are contaminated. It's the practical reality. And they think you're an ordinary person, or else they find fault with you. That will be apparent right in the midst of the Rajasuya Yajna. After the Agra Puja, before the Agra Puja, which is required for the Rajasuya Yajna, the worship of the foremost person who's present in the assembly, Yudhisthira Maharaj thought, Krishna's a shoo-in. And no one will deny. When it's time to select a person for the Agra Puja, everyone will know it's Krishna. At the same time, he was shrewd. In this world, there are some whose hearts contaminated. But when Krishna gets the Agra Puja, the worship of the foremost person present, that'll firmly establish amongst demigods, sages, brahmacharis, in other words, amongst people who count. Yudhisthira Maharaj is not vox populi in the contemporary way. He wants to impress the significant people of the whole universe. Sages, sadhus, yogis, brahmacharis, demigods, even Brahma, Shiva. Let them all come. Let them see. So, there was a discussion. Yudhisthira was allowing a little democracy. Discuss who is the most glorious person here. It's a very good tactic. So that people themselves would realize it's Krishna. Please, the assembly, discuss who is the most glorious person here. And there was a little discussion about it. Actually, there shouldn't have been a discussion for very long. So the acharyas point out that you had Brahma there, you had Shiva there. Why didn't they immediately say Krishna? They know. Brahma says, Govindamadi Pushantamamajami. Shiva in the fourth canto of Bhagavatam, you read his song, his mantra that he gives to the Prachetas, glorifying Krishna. So, why didn't Brahma, Shiva say anything when it was this kind of momentary lull? In other words, not immediately did everyone say, Krishna should get the Agra Puja. What's going on? Why didn't Brahma Shiva say anything? The acharyas say that they were thinking, well, no one asked us specifically, so why should we say it? The devotees say like that. No one asked me, what do you want me? They didn't ask me to do the service. Why are you blaming me? They didn't ask my opinion, right? It happens in the temple sometimes. They didn't ask me. Why was the problem? Why was there a problem with the festival? They didn't ask me. I told them, if they asked me, I would have said something. They didn't ask. So be it. I just took the humble path, didn't say anything. No offense. They never had problems because I was humble. So, Brahma and Shiva were thinking like that. No one asked us, so we'll just be quiet. But they said, in addition though, Sahadev is there. He's very shrewd. They knew he'll say something. If Sahadev doesn't say anything, then we'll speak up. But since no one asks us, we'll keep quiet and we'll wait till Sahadev comes forth. And indeed, Sahadev came forth and made the presentation. Why, obviously, Krishna should get the Agra Puja. And there was a tremendous uproar of approval when Krishna was selected. But there was, as you know, someone festering like a sore in the background. Shishupal. But Shishupal didn't say anything immediately. He let the Agra Puja go on. And he wanted, you see, the acharyas explained that Shishupal wanted the actual yajna after the Agra Puja. He wanted the actual yajna for the Rajasuya to get going so that at that time, if he caused the disruption, the whole sacrifice would be ruined. So he knew what he was doing. It's all about timing. When it came for the selection for the Agra Puja, he didn't say anything. He was just festering in the background. But after Krishna got the Agra Puja, and once the sacrifice actually began, Then he said something. Wait a minute. He was like waving his hands in the background. Wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. And then he was blaspheming Krishna with maximum velocity. How can you select Krishna? You listen to this young boy, Sahadeva? What fools you are. I can understand now. He could philosophize. I can understand now the effects of eternal time. Even the intelligence of the greatest sages has been bewildered. There are so many glorious persons in this assembly. Any one of them could have received Agra Puja. But you listened to this foolish young boy and you chose Krishna. And then he began to directly blaspheme Krishna. Krishna, what caste is he? Is he Vaishya? Is he a Kshatriya? What is he? We don't know. What's his family background? Who knows? Of course, he's actually speaking truth. Krishna is of no varna. He has no family in the ordinary sense. But of course, Shishupal meant all the statements and the blasphemous. And then he wound up with his grand finale. I think that Krishna is no better than a crow. But at this point, the Pandavas and other kings in the audience, they were reaching for their swords, which is exactly what Shishupal wanted. Because if blood is shed in the yajna, the whole yajna is finished. It's ruined. So he knew he was strategic. He was an administrator. He knew how to make a mess. The tactics. So he purposely was speaking like that. He's no better than a crow. He didn't do that. And the Pandavas were tugging at their swords and the other kings, and some just couldn't tolerate it anymore. They just covered their ears and walked out of the assembly. And they felt they couldn't do anything about it. They couldn't defeat Shishupal. So they just left, as the Shastra prescribes in his blasphemy. And as the other kings were reaching for their swords, and Shishupal just went mad. He pulled out his own sword. Come on, come on, come on. You know what I said? Come on, come on. He was just going to totally destroy the yogi. Because he knew one drop of bloodshed, it's over. All these costly arrangements for the yajna, the untold opulence required, it'll all be in vain. I'll have ruined everything. But Krishna outsmarted him. What did Krishna do? He sent his Sudarshan Chakra, which severed the head of Shishupal without shedding a drop of blood. It was a clean cut. That way, the yajna wasn't ruined. That is how expert Krishna is. So, let us remember not to be intimidated by this idea that all paths lead to the same goal. First of all, know what the goal is. Secondly, demonstrate, tell us what is your vantage point in which you get an overview and you can see all the paths converging somewhere. Otherwise, it's very cheap to say all paths lead to the same goal. Well, what's the goal? Well, you know the whatever. You can't say in words. You can't say what it is, but all paths lead there. It's very cheap to say that. Then, if you say that Krishna is not the ultimate destination, that statement implies you have knowledge. Now, please tell us why Krishna is not the ultimate destination. We're not sectarian. We're open to hearing your presentation. So please conclusively demonstrate. Please exhaustively describe, what is the ultimate destination? Well, I don't know, but I do know one thing. It's not Krishna. Then what? This is why Prabhupada writes in the beginning of Krishna book that anyone who actually knows what is God will accept Krishna as the Supreme Personality of God. Automatically. If you actually know what is God. So that is our responsibility, to educate people exactly what is God. Rather than just be intimidated. We don't want to come off sectarian. We don't want to, okay, we won't say Krishna. We won't refer to Krishna. That way everyone will love us. No, you despair, Maharaj. He's showing you how to do Sankirtan. He's showing you how to stage festivals. He's showing you how to, with resources, management, opulence, strategies, establish the three objectives. In this way, Yudhisthira is showing his ecstatic love for Krishna. All right, any questions? Okay, I'll get away from them. Oh, yes.
We see sometimes even people who are religious, like we see before in this Leela, Jarasandha, I heard his next life he become this Emperor Aurangzeb or something. He was a religious man. And then even the religious men sometimes they may hate Krishna how people can hate Krishna for us devotees.
As Prabhupada said, anyone who actually knows what is God. Those people don't actually know what are the characteristics of Godhead. They need education. And that's our responsibility. Just as Yudhisthira is taking up his responsibility out of love, similarly, we take up our responsibility to educate the people out of love, to actually know what is God. That's why in the beginning of the Krishna book, Prabhupada explains that Krishna is accepted as the Supreme Personality of Godhead by the greatest personalities of the universe. It's not just some man off the street's opinion. Yeah, Krishna, right, yeah. Okay, yeah, I'll vote for him, Krishna. No, the greatest personalities in the universe. Then you have to understand who are the greatest personalities of the universe. But mundane society is presenting you so many false heroes and false celebrities that waste your time. And therefore you can't consider that there are great personalities of the universe far beyond the range of your sense perception. The Bhagavatam is presenting them to you. That's why Yudhisthira says, Brahma will be invited, Shiva will be invited. He knows who to call for. Brahmacharis, yogis, gyanis. In other words, as chief executive, he knew who the most important people in his territory are. Not the sports stars and the entertainers. All right. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So we have some Sankirtan scores from yesterday in Radha's boutique. That doesn't make any sense. So in Closet Krishna, one Maha Big Book was distributed with 140 Lakshmi points.
Evo!
And in Govinda's Transcendental Prasad Distribution Restaurant, there was 234 customers served for 1,847 Lakshmi points. They don't seem to be any of those. So we'll just say the plan. And before we do that, Would there be any volunteers here to help serve prasadam?
Yeah.
Okay, great. And anyone who could help clean the temple room afterwards? Anybody else who helped clean the temple room? Maybe one other person? Okay, great. Thank you very much. So we have some books for us, yeah.
Shot.
So book distribution yesterday. Back to Jake. 4 lakshmi, 2 million books for 1 book point. Bhaktin Dipti, 47 lakshmi, 10 big books for 10 book points. Sachi Kumar Nimai Das, 35 lakshmi, 40 million books for 20 book points. Bhaktin Vilma, 54 lakshmi, 26 million books, 5 mahabig for 23 book points. And back to Nir, 118 lakshmi points, 113 medium books for 56.5 book points. Shilpa, transcendental book distribution key.
Yeah.
So now we will say the prayer. Dei Shri Shivadananda Nishram. Jagannath Baladev and Subhadra. Shri Shri Gauranathai. And Giri Govindhan. We request your causeless mercy upon us. For your pleasure, if you so desire, we wish to erect a holy place of your transcendental pastimes, which will attract unlimited souls to your service and fulfill the vision of your pure devotee, Srila Prabhupada Shivananda.
Please enable us to cooperate together
in order to satisfy you in this way. We, your surrendered servants, humbly beg. New temple for the Lordship's ki jai. All hands to the prasadam chain.